my side. I'm going to talk today about the new diesel engine, and Mark Gillies asked me to be authentic. That's a German presentation, that I give you the presentation in German today. I hope that's all okay for you. So, schönen guten Morgen. Ich möchte ein bisschen erzählen über den neuen Dieselmotor. Just kidding. Let's first have a look at Volkswagen's history of diesel here in the US. So we started in 1976. We launched a Golf with 50 horsepower. We heard from Jörg earlier, today we are at 150. So this is how we started, 1976, the Golf, or Rabbit called in this country, with a 50 horsepower diesel engine. Then we had the major development from 50 horsepower to 54 horsepower, the engine that we also installed in the Volkswagen Vanagon. From there on, it took some time. Then in 1993, we went up to 90 horsepower, and first time as a Tier 1 certification. Then we increased horsepower again to 100 horsepower in the 1.9 liter. And then is what I would see, I know climax is the wrong word, but as the climax of the diesel development, we had our 10-cylinder diesel engine in the Touareg, which cranked out 310 horsepower. Then, unfortunately, we got new emission regulations here in the US, so we had to comply with BIN 5 or ULEV standard all over the US. So we decided we want to sell diesel not only in the federal states, we want to sell diesel in the California states as well. We launched the first clean diesel in 2008, the 140 horsepower in the Jetta Mark V. With this technology, we won in 2009 the Green Car of the Year, and with the same technology, just with a different car, we won again the Green Car of the Year in 2010 in the Audi A3 clean diesel. So, what were our objectives to develop a new diesel? So, of course, our first objective was we have to use a modular system. If I compare an old European Euro 5 engine to what we sold here before in the former model years in the US, they don't have a lot of common parts. The engine looked totally different. And if you then put this in volume perspective, you have seen Mark's volumes chart earlier. We are selling more than 2 million diesel worldwide, four-cylinder diesels, but we are selling only 100,000 or around about 100,000 here in the US. So this wasn't balanced. So we needed something that we can gain from the scale effects that we have in Europe with the high volume that we sell. The next thing, we wanted to have a CO2 neutral reduction of NOx raw emissions. In this case, we even overachieved. You saw the new fuel economy numbers. We were able to increase fuel economy by a lot, and we reduced the NOx raw emission of the engine by 40% in order to comply with future emission regulations like Tier 3 or LEV 3. We have a scalable NOx aftertreatment. I will show this in detail later. One thing that was very important for us and that helped us a lot with the US regulation is in Europe we have something called Euro 6 Level 2, and they focus on real driving emissions. So you have one time, you have your emission test that you do on the dyno, but they also measure emissions while driving on the road. And they have some thresholds there, and we designed this engine to meet those thresholds. I mentioned before we wanted to have high synergies between the US engines and the Euro engines for scale effects, and we mentioned this before here, Jörg mentioned it, we insourced a lot of the parts for the electric vehicles. We did the same here. We insourced the whole software development for the diesel engines. We still have three suppliers for engine control units, and every time we needed a change, we needed to call all three of them and tell them, please change this. And of course, everybody changed it a bit different, so the results were different. So by now, we do the software ourselves. We send them our package of software, and they implement it in their ECU. This is one of the major changes that we did for this diesel engine. So how is the basic architecture of this engine? So we start out with an engine, with a 2-liter engine with balancer shafts. Out of this engine, this 2-liter engine with balancer shafts, we have two different versions. We have a 2-liter without balancer shafts, which can be pretty useful, for example, in Europe to differentiate brands. So you can put in a less expensive brand like a Skoda, I can put an engine without balancer shafts, and in a higher end vehicle like an Audi, I can put the engine with balancer shafts. And of course, we have a 1.6 liter engine, and because of the lesser free forces, we have no balancer shafts in the 1.6 liter. But The cylinder head is the same on all the engines. It doesn't matter what the short block is. The cylinder head is the same on a 1.6 liter, on a 2 liter with and without balancer shafts. The same is true for the intake manifold, the whole intake system. We have an integrated intercooler here. It's a water-cooled intercooler that is sitting in the intake manifold. This is also the same on all the engines. And the same is true for the canning of the exhaust gas system. So on all engines, no matter on which, for which market it is, this looks always the same. If it's for Euro 4 market somewhere in Africa, or if it's for the US, the canning is always the same. It's, the difference is what is inside for it. But by going to this, we are now able to source more than 2 million of these cannings. We just change what's inside. For the intake system, together with our supplier Valeo, who developed this system together with us, we won the PACE Award last year as one of the great innovations. So the first thing we learned from the engine that we have currently in the Jetta, you have to keep your ways for your exhaust gas as short as possible if you want to use EGR. So I will go up here and try to point this out. So what we, for example, did for the high pressure EGR, we integrated the channel that's going from the turbocharger back to the intake manifold in the cylinder head. So it's not a tube outside that's running anymore. We integrated this into the cylinder head. And on the other side, what you see, this big black tube that's going from the turbocharger to the intake manifold, because the intercooler is now integrated in this, we were able to get a much better throttle response than we had before. Talking about throttle response, I can only emphasize what Scott said before. Please be aware of the speed limits here. I had this case twice. That I once was with a journalist, the other one with a real customer, that with prototype vehicles and prototype engines, we got pulled over and the police wanted to impound the vehicle. We don't have prototypes cars here, but we don't want you to have this experience. Please stick to the speed limits. And it's not fun to drive down to the police and do the negotiations that we can get you and the car back. But I can tell you a German accent helps. If you look in the archives of Eurotuner, you will find one incident. So what else did we do on the engine? We did something very unusual here. We rotated the valve stem by 90 degrees. So I had last night somebody ask me, do you do cam phasers on exhaust and intake camshaft? And I told him, wait for tomorrow. So what we did here, we rotated the valve stem. So now on each camshaft, we have one intake and one exhaust valve. We don't have one camshaft with intake anymore and one with exhaust. We have on each cam, we have one. And on one camshaft, we put a cam phaser. So now we are able to run something like a Miller cycle at low RPMs with these engines. So you can see the operation here. So you have, basically, we can now adjust one camshaft to the other. And the nature of a diesel engine is that at low RPMs and lower loads, you only utilize one intake runner anyhow, because of the design of the intake runners at lower RPMs, we are utilizing one, and now we can influence this one and run what's called a Miller cycle in engine development. We can run this, so meaning that the intake valve opens much later than it used to be, which gives you advantages in fuel economy and emissions. We are able to adjust 50 degrees crank angle, which reflects 25 degrees camshaft angle. So the next thing that we heavily modified to achieve all this was the injection system. The injection system, we are now running up to 2,000 bars in the system. The old engine ran 1,600 bars. The first thing what we did, we integrated something that we call the mini rail. So you have your high pressure fuel rail outside. This is feeding inside the injector, but we store the diesel that's needed for the next injection process, we store it inside the injector already. So we are not prone to any fluctuation of pressure anymore in the rail. We always have the needed pressure available in the injector system. So this red area that you see here is what we call the mini rail, where we store the diesel for the next injection process. The next thing that we did, we redesigned the whole system a bit. we took in former injectors, those needles were several parts or they were shorter. We designed one needle, which is a three-part welded piece. We designed one needle that is going all the way from the bottom to the top. So we don't have any flexing of the needle anymore. We don't have any inaccuracies while closing the injector at the bottom. With this, we were able to get a very precise spray pattern. And you see this little red area down in the bottom? This is where we are guiding this needle. So we try to put the guide for the needle as close as possible to the bottom where actually you create your spray pattern. We create this spray pattern with what we call the nano blind hole. So you see these tiny little red holes there next to the bottom of the needle. This is where we create the spray pattern. Okay, so that's new for the injector. Let's go to the after treatment. So as I said before, the after treatment, the canning for the after treatment is the same for all the engines. It's the question what is inside. All these sensors you see here, most of them are needed to comply with OBD regulations here in the US and more coming in other markets. One thing that we developed new for this is our SCR or DEF dosing module. Because we put the dosing module so close to the engine, so close to the turbocharger, we had to water cool it. Otherwise, it would have just melted away. So on other engines, where you find it somewhere under the car, like our old generation Passat, it's not water cooled. But here we had to water cool it because we wanted to close couple it as much as possible. Right in front of this, you have the oxidation catalyst, which you have on any diesel engine, even if you only have a Euro 4 engine. Then you have our mixing chamber. I will show you an animation later on what's going on there. And then you have the diesel particulate filter. So now those of you that are familiar with diesel should ask me, hey, you forgot one thing. Normally you have three cans on a diesel. You have your oxidation catalyst, you have your particulate trap, and you have your SCR converter. Where's your SCR converter? That's correct. What we did, we integrated the SCR converter into the DPF. It's one part now. In former times, that used to be two parts. By now, it's one part. How did we design this part internally? Basically, it's a porous core where the exhaust gas can enter on one side and need to go across it and then exit on the other side. The big advantage we have with this system is the last one. We have a low exhaust back pressure because we eliminated one more can that's down there in your exhaust system. We were able to reduce the exhaust back pressure significantly, which helped us, which is one of the major reasons why we have the higher horsepower number. You saw the horsepower numbers that Jörg showed earlier. We went from 140 to 150. The reduced back pressure helped a lot in this higher horsepower number. So, as I said, I wanted to show you how our mixing chamber works. Normally, your SCR dosing module sits right in front of your SCR converter and just injects on the front of this. What we did here, we put it on the side, and then we have these little metal deflector plates in there, and with this little deflector plates, we are able to distribute the diesel emission fluid very evenly. This gives us the big advantage that we don't have urea deposits in there. In the regular cars, from time to time, we find urea deposits in the middle of the converter where it's injected. And on the side of the converter, you see less conversion grades than you see in the middle. So with this, we were able to distribute it very evenly and to make the whole system a bit smaller and to be able to do this integration of diesel particulate trap and the SCR converter. That's new what's about this. So that's from my side. I now hand over to Vinay for the